Thanks for inviting me to speak today, and it's been a really great conference, so thanks again to the conference organisers. I was a bit torn by what I should present today, but I think what I am going to present is really interesting because it follows on quite nicely from Robin's talk yesterday. But if anyone's interested in methods for estimating male fertility, that's also kind of what I work on, which is a completely different research question to this one. This is kind of work that I've done over the past few years with collaborators, Sam, Swapnil, Seth, and Axel, who are based kind of all over the place now, but we all started working together at Imperial during the COVID pandemic. So the plan for my talk is to look at three different methods that I've developed that are building towards a spatio-temporal disease transmission model, but most of the work that I've done so far is only on temporal disease transmission. So to start off with some context, everyone knows a lot about COVID-19, but the other disease that I've worked on a lot is malaria. If you work with Ben Lambert, I'm sure you also know a lot about malaria. But according to WHO, there are a lot of malaria cases and a lot of deaths worldwide. It's a really important disease and it impacts a lot of children, especially. And what I'm really focusing at is countries which are close to elimination. So these are countries where local transmission is interrupted and most of the diseases occurs due to importations. So malaria cases coming in, perhaps due to people traveling to that country for a holiday or something, or more likely for work. And we consider malaria elimination countries almost like an outbreak, a disease outbreak setting, where a disease, a case comes in over the border and spikes a local outbreak of cases that eventually then becomes contained. And we're not looking at the kind of the long-term transmission behavior, which lots of other models do look at. So the type of method that I first looked at is a method called a Hawkes process. For those who are kind of more mathematically inclined, you define it in terms of the bottom. But you model Hawkes processes, think of in terms of intensity. So in terms of disease, you think of the force of infection of the disease in a country. And this is equal to kind of your background contribution, which we think of as imported malaria cases, or perhaps like a spillover. If it was looking at Ebola, it would be like a spillover from a zoonotic reservoir. And then to that, we add the contribution to the intensity from person-to-person transmission. So with Ebola, this would be kind of like direct transmission with bodily fluids. But it's a little bit more complicated with malaria because there's a vector, there's a mosquito that transmits the disease. And we encode this within the dynamics. So we kind of assume it's person to person, but that is like a big assumption, and we do need to remember that there's a mosquito that's involved. Why do we consider Hawkes processes? Well, it's a really well-established method for earthquake modeling, social media, financial modeling, but when we first started looking at it, it wasn't really used very much for infectious disease modeling. But there's definitely at least one or two people in the room who have used this for infectious disease modeling, to shout out to those. So it's analogous to a susceptible, infected, recovered, or SIR model that's traditionally used in epidemiological modeling. And you can encode disease-specific information, such as like your shape of your serial interval or any seasonality that's related to the disease, which is really important for malaria. It's really easy to fit to, kind of use maximum likelihood, expectation maximization, or now there's some Bayesian methods to do it. And we were kind of saying it's hopefully quicker to fit and simulate from. So the simulation method that I used for the paper that I'm going to show is not very efficient, and I'd really recommend using cluster-based rather than intensity-based simulation if you're actually going to work with this. So look at how we parameterize the model for malaria. So we start by looking at the first term, which is the contribution to the intensity from the imported malaria cases. So here we know that malaria transmission is really seasonal, but also in these countries which are getting close to elimination, we wanted to be able to have like a linear term to enable the importations to be decreasing over time, as well as reflecting the seasonal profile. So we had like a constant linear term plus a sinusoidal term. And here's an example of the fit backgrounds from two data sets that we looked at in China and Eswatini. And then we looked at how we parameterized the kernel. So the idea was here that we wanted to use the data that we know about malaria transmission to define a shape of our intensity kernel, but then fit the magnitude and kind of the how long you remain infectious for, because this can depend on things like treatment. So like I said, we wanted to encode the mosquito dynamics. So we assumed that a person once infected couldn't go on to infect another person for 15 days, hence this like lag here and this term here. And then we imposed like the rally shape, so kind of a traditional shape of a serial interval. And we fitted these alpha and delta parameters using maximum likelihood in this example. And we found like we got pretty similar shapes between our two different kernel. We got similar shapes because our we defined that, but the temporal dynamics are pretty similar for the two countries, but we got a very different magnitude, which could be down to things like how many people got treated for the disease. We are packaged for this, so it's kind of code available if anyone wants to try apply Hawk's processes to their different diseases. People have now done this work for Ebola and various other diseases. And we found that with this method, we were really able to tease apart what was driving transmission. Here's an example for China. So on the left is kind of all the daily cases, and on the right is the daily importations. So we didn't fit to importations, we just fit to the time series of data. And you can see that the shapes are very similar because most of the cases were being driven by importations, but the magnitude is slightly different. The red line is our raw data, and the black lines are kind of 10,000 simulations from our Hawk's process that we drew to see kind of whether our fitting had worked. Ignore the purple line. This was a comment that from a reviewer who was asking us to fit to kind of a null model, which really didn't work for the situation. But the graphs are really difficult to plot, so I haven't replotted them without that line. But kind of the idea is that we were able to use this data to tease apart and learn that importations are really driving transmission in China, which is really important for elimination planning, because they're learning that really they have local malaria transmission under control. Now looking at building on this, looking at whether you can incorporate genetic information within a Hawk's process to really work out if we can recreate transmission trees and really learn about the importations rather than just looking at a kind of population level. During kind of my research process, I kind of reached that stage, and then COVID-19 hit. And we started thinking about whether Hawk's processes were the best thing to be using for COVID. One of the limitations of a Hawk's process is you need unique event times. So you need to know the exact time an infection occurred. And with COVID-19, we really didn't know this. We were getting, for starters, death data rather than infection data. And we were learning that tens, hundreds, thousands of people were infected on one day. So we decided that Hawk's processes weren't necessarily the best way to go. So we switched to a kind of different model, which is really, really related, called a renewal model. And this is a type of model that Robin spoke about yesterday. So instead of switching from an intensity framework, we're now looking at modeling kind of the raw number of infections. So here we get that our number of infections is equal to this time-varying reproduction number that we introduced to yesterday. And for a recap, that's the number of secondary infections that a primary person would go on to infect, multiplied by this kind of summation of how much infectiousness there is in the population. So looking at every person who's infected, where they are through their kind of serial interval or generation time, and then calculating the total amount of infectiousness to then work out how many new people would be infected the next day. I use T for kind of the time step and M for the kind of region that we're looking at. So we created a Bayesian multi-level model, so kind of looking at sharing parameters between different countries. And this is really analogous to the Hawk's process, where kind of this term here is basically this term here in the Hawk's model. if it's written out kind of in its more renewable and its more formal framework, you also get this kind of mu term here. But with COVID-19, there was very little data early on about importations. So we kind of ignored that. Countries closed their borders. So we were saying that that was really, really small. So we built this into kind of a bigger framework where we were fitting to deaths because that was the data that we had rather than cases. So we said that our observations were these kind of deaths, and we assumed that they were negatively binomially distributed. I've put kind of information about the priors that we used on the screen. If they mean something to you, great. If they don't worry about it. It's just kind of, we used a Bayesian model. And in case anyone's interested, I can't remember them off the top of my head, so I thought it was better to put them on the screen. Because our renewal model, kind of the underlying transmission dynamics, is based on infections, we had to relate our kind of infections to our deaths, which is what we had the data for, because if you remember, testing was really poor early on in the pandemic. So we use an infection fatality ratio. We didn't want to kind of estimate this in our model framework, so we were using external data, the original estimates of IFR that were produced by other groups were for very specific settings, very specific demographies. So we weighted these based on the situations that we were looking at, and then allowed a little bit of noise in case that the estimates weren't didn't fit the data very well. So we said that our deaths were equal to this infection fatality ratio, and then infections don't occur kind of at the same time as a death. A person gets infected first, and then there's a period of time before they then go on to die, if that's what happens. So then we have this onset to death distribution here, which allows us to kind of convert between our deaths and our infections in our model. And here is just the kind of the data that we use to parameterize the onset to death distribution. And then one of the things that we're really interested in doing is not only just getting kind of an estimate for RT, but also looking at what was kind of impacting RT. And we were, first thing we looked at was step changes in different interventions that were put in place. So if you're in the UK, we kind of had kind of like sent home from work, there was gathering stoppings, and then eventually a lockdown. So we were wanting to look at kind of the effect sizes of all these different interventions. So we parameterized our RT with a basic reproduction number, which was representing kind of the disease dynamics in the naive population. And then we had this exponential relationship with indicator variables, which were step changes for our different interventions. You could have parameterized this however you like, and then I'll go on to explain some of the things we did later on to parameterize it. We first looked at the impact of interventions for 13 European countries. So we had this kind of nice model diagram where we went from observed deaths to model deaths, and then we used the equation I showed before to go from deaths to infections with the IFR. And then we had this time-varying reproduction number, which also comes into your infections equation that I showed earlier. And this was done on the effect sizes for different countries. And the idea was, it was really difficult if you just looked at one country's data to work out how effective different interventions were, because sometimes people put in three things on the same day. So we shared information between 13 countries in Europe. I think the paper has a few more. We wanted to work out kind of the effect sizes and whether the all-important question of whether lockdown was really necessary, although please don't ask me about the politics of that. I'll just show you some numbers. So these are kind of the estimates that we got out of the model. So we had our modeled infections for each of our countries. The text is really small, but this is for France, Italy, Spain, and then the UK. Then we had our model, our observed deaths, which are the pink bars, and then our death model. And then this is what we estimated RT for. And then the little tiny shapes are the different interventions. And you can see that kind of they allowed step changes in RT, and some things brought RT less than one. We found out that actually it was lockdown in our model that that was the only thing that had a huge reduction in RT. And we looked at whether there was a difference in effect sizes if the intervention was put in place first or as a later intervention. I actually focused more on our implementation in the US than in Europe. And for here, like during the outbreak, we got more information about mobility data. And this has kind of started on the spatial idea of the model. We got within region mobility. So Google produced kind of nice data on changes in mobility from a baseline. And we incorporated that into our model down here instead of the intervention data. And here we kind of have a more complicated RT where we had different effect sizes of different interventions and had different groupings. So some parameters we shared between all states, some of them we shared between regions, and some parameters were for a state level. We also realized that not all kind of changes in RT reflected in mobility changes. So we added this kind of extra term at the end, which kind of soaked up all the other things. Here we found kind of effect sizes of kind of same thing, similar things. And here it was like reductions in average mobility, which we found were driving changes in RT as a paper and also kind of our code. But what's really nice is some of our collaborators created an R package for this called Epidemia, which is kind of similar ideas to what Robin presented yesterday in terms of Epi-Estim. But I'd recommend kind of checking this out. It's much slower than Epi-Estim, although we're kind of working on ways to fix that. But kind of this got me thinking about the question about what happens if you want to incorporate modeling infections between regions. So we didn't really have access to this data during the pandemic, but we are starting to get access to this type of data now, where we can really look at kind of, instead of modeling however many regions separately and producing an RT for each region separately, can we create one model which enables kind of the idea that people move between regions to be incorporated. Kind of think of this as people can get infected in three ways. They can either get infected by somebody in their home region when they're in the home region. They can stay in their home region and somebody can kind of commute in for work and infect them. Or you can go out to work, get infected in the region that you work in and bring those infections back. So kind of changed now, instead of having one term in our kind of infection equation, which is very similar to like the first term, we now have three terms, and we can parameterize this model, this kappa, which is kind of like the probability a person goes to each region using mobile phone data. So here we have kind of, it's very likely that a person in A stays in region A, but there's some likelihood that they travel to place B unless that they travel to C, D, and E. And we have some data, but I'm not sure about, I haven't like plotted it for you because I'm not sure about data sharing. And put some preliminary results in. So here's kind of the beginning of the alpha wave for Greenwich. And we look at comparing the results between a non-spatial model in red and a spatial model in blue. I wouldn't say kind of too much about kind of the differences. The non-spatial model is a lot better set up than the spatial model. Spatial model is kind of preliminary research that I've kind of looking at. I'm not sure that the spatial model is seeded quite right, but this is the area kind of I'm really interested in working on at the moment. There's some really big problems in terms of computation. When you do each region separately, you can send them off to different computers and kind of do that. But when you're looking at this type of model where everything's interconnected, it's much harder to do parallelization. So I haven't managed to kind of set up this kind of running yet. It's all written in Stan. I'm not sure that it Stan's necessarily the best programming language to use this. So hope to spend some time over the next few months and years kind of looking at whether we can make these types of models more efficient so we can create a general kind of spatial transmission, spatial temporal transmission model kind of based on the renewal type rather than like an agent based or a compartmental model. So that's kind of the end of my talk. Does anyone have any questions?
Thanks for a very interesting talk. Comments? Question?
I actually just have one clarification. So in one of the slides, you were showing the onset from infection to death, and I saw you had a sum of two gammas. Why is that? This one.
I can't remember off the top of my head, but definitely let's have this conversation offline. Yeah, because
it's definitely something very interesting, and I was thinking maybe there's like a certain explanation for why would you have like...
I'm sure that there I think it's because we do onset to symptoms to death, or break them up. But
I see.
I can pull up the kind of paper and we can go through that afterwards.
Okay, thank you. Sorry.
Hi. On your last slide... I know you said that you thought the way you'd done the spatial model was a bit funky, so maybe that's the answer to the question. It seems like you have more confidence in the number of cases with the spatial model, but less confidence in the reproduction number through time. And that seems unintuitive to me. Do you have a sense of what's up with that?
No, I haven't really, really kind of gone into it. I think there's some very strange things kind of going on. It's not properly kind of... It's not got enough regions in it, I don't think. I think this is done for 4 interconnected regions, which is probably skewing a lot of the results. But definitely interesting question and something that I will think about as I debug kind of what's going on.
Okay, thank you.
You said you thought maybe the seeding wasn't right for the spatial model. And I think that's something that's a problem for a lot of spatial models. People who've tried to do whole country simulations of COVID for the UK have had a lot of trouble initializing their models properly. Is there any data on seeding, or is there any way of trying to work out what the where cases might have been seeded for different waves and how they subsequently spread?
Yeah, so kind of my idea for this kind of bit of the project is to use alpha wave, and there's data somewhere, I'm not exactly kind of sure who owns, and kind of it's UK data is just a bit complicated. You can get dropout. But you can look at kind of whether it's like alpha wave or wild type, and we're kind of using that. And the idea is, what I wanted to do initially was seed it from kind of the borough in London where it occurred first, plus somewhere in Kent, and then try and seed everything from that. And that's kind of what I have done here. But I'm not sure that's necessarily the best way, because it might have been occurring in other regions and just not tested for and picked up. But I think I agree, kind of seeding is kind of very important. And I think there's some kind of projects going on looking at how identifiable kind of importations are. And I think if those methods kind of set up and running, then that would be amazing, because then we can use them to kind of seed some of the stuff.
If I could just ask a question. Thanks, Etty. I guess I was wondering what you just said at the end there about the non-parallelizability of this model and estimating the RT separately. It's just a comment, really, but have you looked at expectation propagation as a way of doing that?
No, I'm okay. Open for kind of all ideas, and perhaps we can kind of chat
yeah.
more.
Yeah, cool. Sounds good.
Thanks, Juliette. In some of the later work with Epidemia, looking at the UK, I think they were fitting jointly to at least 3 of cases, infections, yep. hospitalizations, deaths, fitting to all of them jointly. So that will depend on the proportion that sort of mm-hmm. progresses to each thing. I thought they were doing it over a long enough time scale that those proportions might be expected to change, like the death rate, in particular the vaccination. Do you know if they were using a random walk for those parameters, or if they're kind of joint-wise, like sort of... piecewise changing over time, or if they were just fixed? Or...
So I'm not entirely sure what Swapnil and Axel were doing for that model. What I can talk about is for the USA model, kind of this kind of framework, we had like one iteration of the model where we purely used deaths, but then we weren't getting such a good fit. So we started incorporating cases from testing. But like you're saying, exactly, there was a problem with testing rates changing. So what we did was we just looked at kind of the last few weeks rather than fixed timescale. I think having kind of these parameters being able to change is really important. And if it's not able to be done in Epidemia, we're currently compiling a list of things that we would like kind of features to be added to Epidemia. So I'll definitely put that on the list.
See, I guess I'll join the list of infectious disease modelers who also have an opinion on RT estimation. First, just to say, I've used Epidemia for some toy stuff, and it was really user-friendly, so that was really good. I guess my, like, kind of question is somewhat philosophical, in that when we're kind of fitting RT models, they're always like grossly misspecified because the true data generating process is so complicated and we're just fitting this like horrible simplification and trying to infer something with it. And we always get really tight confidence intervals as well because there's so much data. So I guess the kind of two-pronged question is, do you guys think about like simulation recovery and think about, you know, related to the talk yesterday about kind of the model you're fitting is misspecified relative to the two true generative models. So like, say, simulating from a complex model and fitting a simple model and seeing how much that affects your RT estimation, if that kind of influences the interpretation of your estimates.
Samir, Bat, kind of everyone branched off and took this kind of modeling to different perspectives. He kind of looked at going back to branching processes and the true generating functions, and has a really nice paper. I can't remember what it is off the top of my head, but looks at the differences between renewal models and Hawk's processes and kind of which can capture the uncertainty better. And I think his idea was that Hawk's processes can better capture kind of the true range of uncertainty. I'll look up that paper. I don't know kind of which stage of...
uncertainty is underestimated.
Yeah. Maybe Lisa knows where it is better, but I'll send it to you in draft if it's not publicly available. Yeah. Do you know what it's called? Yeah. We can get send it to you.
But I guess just like really quickly, like specific question, do you often do simulation recovery before you report, say, like country level estimates? Because that always really bothers me. If we would just go straight to fitting to real data and we're saying, okay, this is really important, this is RT for a country. But it's like, you know, it's a very like confident estimate, but it might be wrong.
Yeah, so I looked at this a lot more with the Hawk's process model and like doing 10,000 simulations of our Hawk's process model. Kind of that wasn't real-time outbreak response work. And I think that's really interesting. And I agree that kind of properly capturing the uncertainty is super important. And it's not necessarily kind of thought of or presented in that way. I've also had problems talking with policymakers who don't want uncertainty. They're like, I just want the number. And we did kind of methods where we didn't give them a central estimate. So I think that's why, I don't know if I can find a plot. There's no kind of central estimate on any of our plots with a kind of idea that how you like tell policymakers is a really important. I think David Spiegelhalter has done kind of a lot of work about the best way to present uncertainty.
Oh yeah, thanks, lovely talk. Kind of related actually. Presumably when you're trying to infer what each lockdown measure did, and they're only a few days apart, there's a huge sensitivity to the shape of your infectiousness distribution and the infection to death distribution. But were those treated as fixed in this, or do you look at this, those being variable things as well?
So some things we put priors on. So we kind of said, we assumed like the infection fatality ratio, we kind of assumed, well, that one we didn't use, we did like a prior on some noise that was added to it. Some of it was using like the fixed values in line with the other types of models that were being presented at the time, with an idea that we were trying to just build up like a collective knowledge about what the parameters were. So sometimes we were told, please use kind of this parameter here. We did a lot of like model sensitivity checks. So what we present here is like the best fit model to the data, but behind the scenes there were lots of kind of different parameterizations, especially for kind of this kind of looked at. We have an exponential here, but it got changed to an inverse logit and lots of things working with kind of statisticians. I wasn't privy to kind of every conversation. There was just a lot of people working on this and a lot of things going on. But the idea was kind of trying to see what fit the data best, trying to be in line with the rest of the modeling efforts that were going on. But I agree, it's really important and should be considered, and we should think about how to kind of build uncertainty kind of in the parameters into these things for real-time modeling in the future.
Thank you. Last question.
We have a question online from Catherine Shepherd. What led you to say that a cluster-based simulation algorithm for Hawk's processes would be faster than the thinning method used? Is there a paper on this, for example?
So I can definitely share some literature with Catherine if she sends me an email offline. It comes down to how we parameterized our Y, and it's not like monotonically decreasing. but you get these kind of peaks. So when you're doing intensity, you kind of assume that if you did an exponential kernel, your maximum intensity is kind of at your time. You spend a lot of time trying to find out when in the future your maximum intensity is to normalize everything. And that causes kind of a big computational headache. Whereas if you can simulate kind of your importations, your background terms first, you then don't have to worry about kind of when the maximum intensity is going to be in the future. You can then just look at each infection individually. If you have a very simple background term, thinning is perfectly good, but it's just because we have a really nasty background term.
Okay, let's thank the speaker and all the speakers of this morning session again.